in the beginning, I had to do a project. So I looked through. I needed to find a topic. I moved towards something I knew. Birds. Surprisingly enough, there are a lot of them. You might even say there are too many birds. I found a sense of wonder. I had a lot of questions. How many birds are there in this area? What is the limit to their population's growth? What allows the birds to reach this population density? Where and how do they stand in the environment? And what is our role accordingly? Our role when correlated with them in our shared environment? What if their role? My search for answers led me to my mentor, and this is how my project began. The grackle's role in the community is approximately comparable to ours. Both of us have direct effects on our surroundings, but unlike the birds, we are consciousness and we are aware of our influence.
What's the role of the grackles?
Their role as far as what?
As far as how do they affect basically all the other animals around, including migratory birds and ones that are local.
Okay, they do affect them in a negative way because they are taking other migratory birds or native birds' habitat. And if you notice, you will only see the grackles congregated wherever there are humans. So like between here and San Antonio and all of that dead space, there's very few to no grackles. You'll only find them where you have all of your human population.
The birds known as the Mexican grackle or the great-tailed grackle, being a medium-sized bird, their body length, not accounting for the tail, can range from 8 to 10 inches. They live from 8 to 12 years. They are sexually dimorphic, with males being generally larger than their female counterparts and fashioning a glossy black coat of feathers, while the female have an opaque brown plumage. The grackle lives mainly in urban areas from Central America to Nebraska. There's 8 recognizable subspecies. The one in the Rio Grande Valley is known as the Prosocobilo. All subspecies share similar build, overall anatomy, but the Prosocobilo is well adapted for long distance flight and flight in windy conditions. These presents common to the area. The subspecies also organizes itself by 3 different levels of complexity. You may call these levels of complexity group hierarchies. The first one of these is known as the pecking order, and this can be observed when they feed. The dominant male raises his head, demonstrating their larger size, and thus determines who will be the first to eat. The first pecker. Females feed on the frenzy of the feeding ground and avoid conflict. Curiously enough, this is what organizes small groups of grackles. It allows them to efficiently find and extract food. Larger birds feed first. To do this, they spread up soil with their larger, presumably stronger beaks, and then they feed. They feed first and feed for the most, which gives them the energy needed to carry this and other tasks out. The other feeders might not eat as much, but they benefit from this order. Once the labor is done, for them to eating, the leftovers is rather simple. This in order allows the grackle to have an organization down to the feeding habits, and this is impressive to say at least. But what effect does this efficiency have? To understand the grackle's relationship with their environment to an approximate level, we could wonder about the effects we have on the environment.
It's recording. All right. Do you believe that we have a negative effect on the fauna?
Yes, a very negative effect on them.
Do you believe that we could do something to improve?
We could stop tearing down certain areas to build like new subdivisions and stuff like that and leave them to the animals. It's as simple as that.
Do you think some fauna advantages from us being here? Basically leaving our scraps?
A little bit, but even then I wouldn't say it poses us too big of it. Something advantageous enough to outweigh all the negatives. You know what I mean?
Do you think we have lost the will to actually look around us, basically?
I feel like the will has diminished a lot. It still exists in some areas and in some people, but I feel that with a lot of other people, it's just not there anymore. They don't really care about it.
Alright. How do you think we could change that?
With the upcoming generations, we can instill in them from a young age that the environment is in danger, and we can give them values that are to treat the environment right and respect it and to not destroy it how we have as of late.
Do you think that would be a positive good?
Yes, I think it would be positive, but I think it would take a long time for it to actually start showing its positive effects.
All right, well, that's basically it.
All right, thanks. Well,
thank you.
Ah, oh, that's...
So there you go.
No, I don't. I know that there is always a willingness to be greener or to be more involved, but I do not see that translate to actual actions as much as I would like to see it. I do know that people would like to be greener or would like to be more eco-friendly, but I don't think that they follow through with that as much as they should.
The environmentalist message is one of the restraints, and that is what the Professor Cortez references to. Most people wish to be green because we are conscious of our great influence. This fuels all of the ideologies of conservation and gives reason to said movements to exist, all which involve awareness and self-restraint as the backbone of the actors. These ideological movements reveal something about our collective consciousness. We know our strengths and what we can do to when uncontrolled, and this worries us. In terms of strength, the birds are comparable. They organize to massive communities which dominate the landscapes. As we can see, they are everywhere and in unlivable quantities, which implies that the grackles are very well equipped for competition. This is what allows the grackle to overrun all other bird species, which share territory, food, nesting grounds, through the process of competition by natural selection. As stated before, there are three organizational hierarchies in which the grackles adhere to. The first, already mentioned, being the pecking order. This structure organizes individuals into efficient feeding grounds, and this is crucial for the bird's success. The second of the three organizational hierarchies is the one in which organizes the birds by family and territory, and is like the hierarchy in the pack of lions. Grackle territories only cater to a set of close family members. Inside these territories, the grackles will only feed, breed, and raise their young. I have observed that the grackles breed sporadically, that is, all year round. I came to this conclusion since young grackles could be seen all through autumn and spring, in moments of warmth in winters, and moderate weather during summer, thus explaining why the population is constantly rising. Since it is always breeding season for the grackle, sexually maturing males are fenced off by larger elder mares, ensuring that only the elder's offspring may live off from the territory. to mark their territory. Mature males find elevated positions and display their calls. As far as it can be heard, that is their territory. During the intersections of spring and autumn, and with summer, this pattern is more self-evident. The territory nature that the male grackles escalates into fights, which determines who has the right to breed and dominates the territory that may one day sustain their offspring. The grackle's behavior is like that of a lion's and is achieved through the same thing. Their fights allow the chain of succession to continue. The older grackles scaring off younger competition makes inbreeding very rare and difficult. These are the key to the bird's success. The birds in this sense are like us. They hold social hierarchy structure, which makes them a powerful entity, which can come to control its surroundings, and in that sense, determines the course of other living beings. The Rio Grande Valley is a region which hosts thousands of migratory species of birds. It concerns me that the grackles may one day invade and take hold of the sanctuaries, as it did with the cities and farmland, where foreign species come for refuge months at a time. The grackles aren't just another bird, which so happens to be very common. It has great influence in the environment, to the point of being of a concern. Because of this, I ask what could have been done to limit them. In other words, what would their growth represent? What will their growth represent to the region, and what could be done to control their population and rate of reproduction? Should this be done? And if so, how?
The only way that you would have a decline in numbers is if you take their resources away, and they have a plentiful amount of resources here. There's trash cans by restaurants. People litter and leave food in the wrappers. So until you take away their resources, the number probably will not decline.
The only reasonable way to stop the grackles' dominance is to reduce their source of substance. But what is this said source? As it stands, we do not know for sure. So to understand their feeding habits, we devised a trap.
The trap is very sensible. That's a good thing for catching the bird, but it's a bad thing to set it off. It's actually activated.
The trap itself is simple. A mouse trap trigger frees a string, which goes through a box and is anchored through the floor. Is the tension between the string and the trigger, which allows the box to remain positioned. And when the trap is set off, the string is released, allowing the box to fall on whatever has set it off. We know that the birds feed on something which the human produces, either intentionally or unintentionally. Could it be the trash or a surplus of insects which resulted from the abundant food, i.e. the trash? Due to the distribution of the grackles in the urban to rural areas, this correlation is clear. We are what allows them to flourish. But the new question stands. How? Because of this, trapping the bird is necessary. It will allow us to see the food preferences of the bird and how it behaves to reach said foods. In other words, we could theoretically set up the experiments to test the bird's ability to solve problems, i.e. intelligence. This information, I believe, is necessary to construe steps to dial down the population of the birds in a more natural manner. Through the bait, we discovered that given a choice, birds would prefer eating natural food sources over processed foods, guiding us stray from the hypothesis suggested by locals and professors I interviewed. The grackles, given a choice between human and natural food, the grackles choose the latter predominantly. When given a choice between the insects / fruits or leftovers, the grackles would choose the natural alternatives. This leads us to reason that the grackles will not feed from human trash predominantly. Once the traps were set, we waited. Sadly, the traps were ineffective. After the traps failed, we had to take them down, made sure they were in good condition to be set up again. But what we did learn from my failures, the birds prefer fruit to bread or other processed food. So for the second time, we set out the traps. To maximize the chances of catching a bird, we expanded our capture window. We put one more trap and waited for 4 days. As far as I can see, the birds were quite intrigued. And due to the circumstance, I stand to believe they will not be a threat to the local sanctuaries anytime soon. This was concluded due to the patterns of behavior the birds showed while eating, i.e., they never had no reason to move away from the urban areas and grazing fields where they eat, breed, and live in. Nevertheless, due to the lack of solid behavioral evidence, which can only be sufficiently gathered through live specimen experiments, I cannot say for sure that they will or will not be a danger for sanctuaries or the thousands of migratory birds in which pass through the RGV yearly. More data is needed to determine that, which makes the traps even more crucial now than ever. Thank you. After half a day, the situation did not appear very promising. Nothing had come close to the new traps. While waiting, I moved around in the car, looking for a community of birds I had been taking footage of. I wished to gather more material, but oddly enough, I did not find them. They left the area where they used to settle in before sunset, but I eventually found them. The last structure of organization is one of like that of a city. This structure of organization I like to call communal hierarchy, and that is what we're seeing right now. A group too large to be a single fact, too large to be organized, too large to be real. But what is real? So how is it organized? These communities, or super flocks, are structurally similar in complexity to human societies. Simply put, the super flock is the organized hierarchy by family groups. These family groups know their place and arrange themselves accordingly to their success. The Grackle family, success means strength in numbers and health, which is demonstrated by the overall noise created by the elder males. Larger and stronger families get better places to sleep in. Smaller or unhealthy families, well, they must settle for whatever is left for them. In this manner, the community of grackle is organized. In this manner, the super flock is formed, and is here where the grackle strength can be clearly seen. This sturdy social structure leads other species of birds to follow the great-tailed grackle. These species can be both helpful and harmful to the grackle population. An example of said species is the European starling, which hijacks the grackle's raising instinct by placing its own eggs and knocking out the eggs in the grackle's nest, leaving the parents to raise the invader's eggs. This, of course, gives another reason for the grackle's territorial nature. So in conjunction, the three levels of complexity work like this. Pecking order organizes feeding and family structure. Familial hierarchies organize individuals to groups. And each family group organizes itself to the community by comparing two things. When they got to go resting, super flocks area, and the family's overall size to that of the other families. Larger families push off subordinate families by pecking, and this organizes the congregation of birds. Because of this, tensions do arise, and the families can gang up in uncooperative members, usually young males from other families, and together, peck until the subordinate birds move. It's enough to say things do not end up well for these males. It might seem cruel, but it is necessary for the cohesion to be maintained. This organization by no means is a simple task, and it is mesmerizing to see it functioning with few to no casualties. But it works. And this allows the birds to zone out larger birds. Because if food starts to run short, they commune to find new feeding grounds by following the other families. In other words, when things get tough for some grackle families, they can follow other families to better swims. Great-tailed grackles can figure out where the food is by conglomerating in massive bird communities, which can be seen through the state of Texas, specifically the Rio Grande Valley. This complex order and ability to adapt to the environment trial social behaviors makes the great-tailed grackle very similar to us. In my opinion, this fact only makes them more of a concern.
I feel as if the current situation, as where if things stand or continue to go down their path, the grackle population will continue to overpopulate and eviscerate the entire animal species of the local area. All native wildlife will be eliminated. There will be nothing but just grackles.
Do you think there's too many?
I think there is a far exceedingly amount of grackles.
What do you think could be done?
I feel as if we could get probably local governments or state sponsors to issue out maybe mustard gas or some bird eliminating agent so we could quietly and effectively induce their long-term sleepage.
Do you believe that animal life in general is important for just the region as a whole and it impacts human life?
Yes, it is extremely important. We need a diverse ecosystem that is self-sustainable, not reliant on human waste or excess food.
Do you believe that observation of our environments has gone down since we became accustomed to be only inside our houses?
The human population is an interesting topic. I feel as if there is a lack or if not no concern to the things that are around us other than our attachment to our electronics. We lack the empathy towards the things around us, or you could say the environment is something that we have lost the caring for.
All right, well, thank you, Gennaro.
Thank you.
That's it.
I believe it is too early to determine if such measures will be necessary or to determine if the grackles are truly of concern. Further research to understand the bird's proclivities is needed. Only then could future behaviors of the great-tailed grackle population be safely and reasonably predictable. Even though the first time the traps were set was a failure, we did learn through baiting them, that the bird would prefer natural foods, as such as fruits or insects, over bread and other human foods, which was helpful in the connecting some dots. Nevertheless, the definite data for predicting behavior is necessary to take reasonable measures. After 4 days since the traps were set, we had returned to check on them. After the initial failure, we hoped the other two caught something. From where I was standing, this seemed to be the case. But as I checked, nothing.
Locks. All right, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
I was devastated. Due to the time restraints for this project, I knew I could not set up more traps. We would not be able to definitely say what the birds prefer to, and the bird's sophistication, which means we do not know for sure what approach to take regarding their population. This was truly a defeat. And while gathering the footage for this documentary, the community of birds completely moved to a different location. This indicates that the birds did not feed predominantly from the trash left behind from humans, but rather feed from a resource which can become and does become scarce, thus supporting the second probable hypothesis for the correlation of urban areas and super flocks. The great-tailed grackle feeds predominantly from the surplus of insects, which results directly from the large quantities of trash produced by local restaurants. This being reason why the great-tailed grackle predominantly lives in urban areas. How they organize and why resting areas seem so packed is due to the species' organizational structure. This structure allows the birds to be very perceptive to change by giving them the ability to sort out the best locations to feed and who should do what, from feeding grounds first to breeding to nesting. But most importantly, the grackle's ability to modify behavior trout through social cues is their main factor for success. It allows them to change along the quickly developing area. And I believe that this, and this alone, is sufficient to explain why the birds have come to dominate the Rio Grande Valley's urban areas. It's the perfect combination of sporadic breeding, the right weather conditions for insects to breed year-round, which gives them a constant food source needed for this group, and some of the best mechanisms to adapt in large numbers to shifting conditions. One thing is for sure, that the great-tailed grackle should not be seen as just another bird. And sadly, that is what I discovered to be the local perception of the animal. And this can't be farther from the truth. They are a part of our community, as important as integral as ourselves, and we should not take them lightly. Go out and see. That is all I have to say.